victory for President Trump. White House correspondent Greg Clugston explains.
When the president signed the 2020 National Defense Bill into law last Friday, he was delivering on one of his top national security priorities, creation of the Space Force. It's the first new military service in more than 70 years. And the mention of Space Force has been a reliable applause line at Donald Trump's political rallies. For the military, it's seen as an affirmation of the need to more effectively organize for the defense of U.S. interests in space, especially satellites used for navigation and communication. Greg Clugston, The White House.
Holocaust survivors gathered at the Western Wall in Jerusalem on Monday to mark the second day of the Jewish holiday of Hanukkah.
In addition to gathering at the Western Wall, hundreds of Holocaust survivors are also taking part in a candle lighting of the Hanukkah menorah in New York, Munich, and Moscow. Colette Avital is the chairperson of the Center of Holocaust Survivor Organizations in Israel on why they gather.
To try to make the Holocaust survivors, those who are with us here today, to bring them some light into their lives.
The eight-day Festival of Light symbolizes the triumph of light over darkness and of democracy over tyranny. I'm Shirley Antler.
Boeing CEO is stepping down with no end in sight for a crisis that has enveloped the manufacturer and its marquee aircraft, the 737 MAX. The Chicago company said Monday that Dennis Muhlenberg will depart immediately. The board's current chairman, David Calhoun, will become president and CEO on January 13th. Boeing's MAX has been grounded worldwide after two crashes. On Wall Street, the Dow by 96 points, the NASDAQ rose 20, the S&P advanced 2. More at townhall.com.
The holidays should be the best of times, but it feels impossible with this credit card debt.
I know Christmas isn't about the stuff we buy, but it's terrible to not have the freedom to take care of the ones I love.
I can't do anything this year because I overdid it last year.
All I want to do is be able to relax and enjoy the holidays and not worry about credit card debt.
You might be having these thoughts right now.
There is hope.
Right now, certified counselors at Trinity Debt Management are standing by and waiting for your call so you don't feel this way next Christmas.
One call and you can get started to financial freedom. Find hope to live your life and the holidays out from under the weight of credit card debt.
Trinity will consolidate your accounts into one easy-to-manage monthly payment.
Put a stop to late fees and over-limit charges, reduce your interest, and possibly improve your credit score. You'll save thousands.
If your credit card debt has you down, we should talk. Call 1-800-990-6976. 1-800-990-6976. That's 1-800-990-6976.
A U.S. diplomat on Monday visited an American jailed in Moscow for nearly a year on spying charges and said he's in good condition mentally. Paul Whelan was arrested at a Moscow hotel at the end of last year and charged with espionage. He faces 20 years in prison if convicted, but the case has yet to go to trial. U.S. diplomat Bart Gorman says the charges against Paul Whelan are bogus.
This arrest, based on claims that Paul was caught, quote, red-handed, are without merit. To date, nearly 1 year later, the investigators have produced no evidence. Zero.
Gorman also says the Russians have not allowed Paul Whelan to contact his family.
Paul has been unable to make a telephone call to his parents. For 12 months, he has made multiple requests, but they've gone unanswered.
Whelan is from Michigan and also holds Canadian, British, and Irish citizenship. News and analysis at townhall.com. I'm Keith Peters in Washington. A dispute over a kid's haircut ends with gunfire at a Texas barbershop.
Harris County Sheriff's deputies are looking for a man who shot a barber in the Houston suburb of Katy during an argument Saturday. Witnesses say a disagreement over the haircut given to the man's son ended with the employee being shot three times before the alleged shooter fled the scene. The injured man was taken to a local hospital where he was listed in stable condition over the weekend. Ron DeRockster reporting.
France's defense ministry says it's carried out its first armed drone strike. The strike killed seven Islamic extremists in central Mali over the weekend. The strike took place as the French president visited neighboring Ivory Coast. France has a military base there. The drone deployment came nearly a month after two French helicopters collided in Mali and killed 13 soldiers. It was the deadliest military loss for France in nearly four decades. The French military successfully tested its weaponized Reaper drone for the first time last week. More on these stories at Town Hall. Facebook.com.
The following is an America Matters Media production. The views expressed do not necessarily represent those of the station or its advertisers, although we think they should. But that's the opinion of America Matters Media.
Stories being told, poems they're old. Stories being told, setting at a time. Stories being told, poems they're old. Stories being told, telling at a time. Oh, set someone right.
Welcome to What's the Story? My name is Janice Hermsen, and I am your host. And we are just so happy to be here today and just shortly before Christmas holiday and getting ready for Christmas Eve and all the fun stuff. You guys all ready?
Yep.
No chance.
Mr. Mom over there, not ready, huh? You got your decorations up, Mr. Mom?
I got a tree up. We got some stuff. I got Christmas dishes out.
Ooh, that's a good
start.
I'm
looking like Christmas.
And how is Fox taking that? Is he warming up to that? Or
so he's so funny, right? It's tough. He's that 60-year-old. Yes. You never know. I'm basically going with comfort food and that kind of stuff. I think he wants the sit down and get fat.
Yeah, we do a little more impromptu on Christmas than Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving's a little more formal, and we like to have the good china out, all that kind of stuff. But Christmas is a little more, you know, it's fun. It's for the kids and grandkids in this case. Well, kids too.
You know, this year we get a little 3-year-old that's coming over.
Oh.
That's what makes Christmas.
It is.
You
it
know,
makes
because
it fun.
It's just to see it in their eyes.
Yeah.
I mean, there's just the wonder that they see. Just makes it so perfect.
Yep, it is. So anyhow, we are looking forward to all of that. And Harold is the author of In All Thy Ways, Going It Alone, Volume 2, and other books. And Harold, are you ready?
I'm ready.
You're ready. All right.
Yeah, let's fire it up.
He's ready to rock.
Rum, rum, rum.
Oh, there we go.
He must have told you about his car.
Yeah.
No?
What? No, I didn't know
I
about it.
Yeah. He told you about his car.
Yeah, I'm an 85-year-old with a Beamer, Z3 Beamer.
Nice. The James Bond?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Awesome.
Maybe I saw you driving around my neighborhood.
Machine guns blaring.
No, you would not have seen me.
Okay.
You would have been on stealth?
I'm that fast. You would have said,
Where, who's that? What
that
was
car's,
that flash?
That car's got the invisibility thing on it anyway.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
It's got those mirrors. Remember on the ice?
I guess I don't know what you're talking about. Christian seems to know.
That's okay. I rarely do. I just smile and agree.
So do you see what I have to put up with, Harold?
I do.
I mean, it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Harold, this is April Kempler.
Hi, April.
April Kempler is the author of The Altered Eye.
Yeah.
Glad you could make
Thank
it.
You.
No,
I know
she,
you were.
Really came
she
in
wasn't late.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you. I'm thrilled to be here.
Oh, that's so funny.
I was actually at a little bit of a surprise book club group for my book, The Altered Eye.
How nice.
Yeah, some fans of Joe's memoir, my father-in-law's name is Joe, came all the way from Red Bluff, California.
Seriously?
Just to meet him.
Oh.
And meet me.
Wow.
How nice is that? What an honor.
I know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sorry we took you away.
It was like when someone throws you a surprise party, but you're not really sure why.
That's why it's a surprise.
That's what it was like. Oh, you came. Yeah, I had no knowledge of it. I just thought I was meeting people that wanted to meet Joe, and would I come to lunch with them? Sure, why not? So when I got there, it was this big
thing.
Yeah, I don't even have the words to express it, but anyhow, not to interrupt you, but yes, that's why I was.
No, you didn't interrupt me.
I'm so sorry.
You're more interesting.
Oh, well, thank you. Yeah, so to Becky, Betty, Anya, Todd, Jody, and
this is like the Musketeer thing, right?
I hope I didn't miss anybody.
No.
Kathy, thank you so much for supporting Joe's
wonderful
book and loving him and making that trip to in this weather from California.
Yes, I know. Over the mountain there.
That's to meet him. He's 91 years old. He's a Holocaust survivor. And this is his story.
Wow. Do you know what's so nice about that? She is so gracious. I mean, you look at Ed and I. We never could have said something like that. You just do that so well. Yeah. I think that's great.
You. Thank you.
Thank you.
But Harold, this is about you. This is your story, Harold.
Oh.
You had no idea, huh?
I had no idea. You know, I have to say I appreciate being here today. And
You may not say that when you leave.
Right. I was going to say that was before he got here.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you better save judgment, huh?
I've launched a lot of voyages in my life. And sometimes it's scary because you're chartering new territory. What's neat about it is when you make port and you've made it. And that's what I feel like here today.
Oh, that's so nice. That's so nice. Well, Harold's book came out last week. Was it last week or the week before? Mm-hmm. Yeah, last week. And I've lost track of, you know, days, times, etc. And your first book, it was called In All Thy Ways.
Yes.
And but that was volume one. And you wrote that with your wife.
Yes.
And then we move on to In All Thy Ways, Going It Alone, because his wife passed.
Oh.
So this is his story, kind of sharing his journey in how to make it alone and make that transition to going it alone. And that's mm-hmm. not an easy thing to do.
No, it isn't. I almost didn't make it.
And that's part of the story.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think there are a lot of people, and especially this time of year during the holidays, it's hard because...
This is very difficult.
Right,
time.
Right.
The memories come back.
Absolutely.
With the one that you lost. And I was able to get through it after I realized that my loss was her gain.
Well, there you go.
And then I was able to get through.
My wife always calls that graduating.
Graduating.
Yeah. No, I think that's a great example.
No, it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is.
That's right.
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting. I can, and seeing your body language, whenever you speak of her, you always look up. Your eyes always go up. I think that's great.
Well, that's pretty
and
cool.
You have a smile on your face, too. So, I think that's great.
That's wonderful. And on that happy note, we're going to take a quick break here. So don't go away. Stick with us. And we're going to hear more from Harold, learn more about this book and his other books. And we'll be right back. You're listening to What's the Story, and that's what we're all about.
Oh.
Hootie hoo.
And just, Harold, so you know.
You're awful quiet over here.
Well, you see, right? I got to fight with these guys for any kind of airtime. Right? And it's tough. They're dog eat dog on that. No, Jan was saying that people can hear us right now.
On Facebook.
Oh.
Yeah, we just want to make sure you know that.
Okay. Yeah.
Because sometimes people speak just. Reference personal things,
yeah.
So we don't want you to do that while you're on air.
Yeah. Right, no,
so. I've done it more than once.
Look at this. Oh, wow. Are you opening that up now?
She didn't hear you. She didn't have her headset on, so she
was willingly quiet.
That's right.
Yeah.
Oh, that's funny. Get that advertising out there, Ed.
Trying, right? Try it.
That's right. I see. It was really bad.
Well, we're not used to being try pod.
That's true.
Right.
Actually, if you put it up on end, people will be able to read it vertically.
I like that idea.
It's
they
true.
Call so much holding it the other way. Might as well put it that way.
Yeah, okay, why not? How funny, I would have done it the other way. Yeah, the other way. There you go, because that's a better choice.
Thank you.
My brother-in-law would say, when he passed one of those to me, he said, take two. And I said, is it that bad?
That's funny.
Ed?
He's not
Please.
Hearing you. I do, yes.
Take
Thank
one.
You. At least he said only one, not two.
That's the first time I've seen him eat something that small.
I know. And not chocolate. Right? Thank you, April.
Oh, you're welcome.
See if I can open this without...
Well, this whole book club thing took me quite off guard, and I don't have any of my things. I don't have a book. I don't know what I'm doing.
Do you have something for your...
I can, yeah.
Okay, good, because I knew you had one last week. So April at the last portion of the show does a little Reno Gal Says.
Okay.
She has a blog called Reno Gal Says. That I think she's updating
and
now.
And I actually have a blog to go with the to go with the so-called blog.
Yeah, you're updating it now, right?
Yeah.
Good.
Can I stay with you through her interview?
You are welcome to stay the whole hour if
okay.
you'd like.
Okay.
We're going to chat about your book the next segment.
That's right.
Then
we don't need to. Yeah.
Book Blitz, and you're welcome to stay for the whole hour.
Stand okay. by. Here we go.
Awesome.
We like having guests.
Yeah, we do.
Adds flavor to the show. Like we aren't flavorful enough, right? And we are back, and everyone's here now. So we're going to get right to talking with Harold Thompson, who is the author of In All Thy Ways, Going It Alone, Volume 2. Harold, before we talk about Volume 2, let's talk a little bit about Volume 1.
Okay.
Let's, you know, have a little discussion about that.
Okay. The name of the book came from Proverbs 3 and verse 5 and 6. And if I may quote it.
You may.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not unto your own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. We took that as a couple when we started going together. We didn't realize the impact that was going to have on our life. Because what took place is that we lived that. And as we talked to people about the Lord, it was just like the Lord saying, you know, Harold and Margaret are always consistent in talking about me. I've got a place for them to go. And so we have gone to places that is just unbelievable to reach people. And I would go into this one mining town that no longer operates, but they still had houses. And we walk the town, just park the motorhome in the middle of the street because there was no traffic, no cars. And I said, I hear hammering. And so we went to this area where the hammering was going on. There's a man. He's redoing a barber shop back in the 1800s. I walk up, I knocked, and I said, can we come in? He said, yes, please. We went in, and I said, you must be a very important person. He said, how's that? I said, because we've been sent all the way from California to meet you and tell you about the Lord. Do you know who he is? Oh, yes. I've got a lot of questions. And so we recognize that the Lord had actually sent us to that man. And that's where it started.
You know, I think that is, and when I started to help you with your book, that was one of the things that I felt was of value, especially is the way you tell your stories are so you and so down to earth and so ordinary and yet profound all at the same time. So I think that for someone looking for, I don't know, another perspective, and it's not preachy, okay?
No.
So a lot of times people say, oh, you know, oh, a God book, right?
Yeah.
And
it
isn't.
More than that.
Yeah, it's not that. It
no.
is really stories of your life.
Yes.
It could be a memoir.
Right.
So.
And so... that started that journey, and it's still going on.
So and then Margaret passed, mm-hmm. right?
How long ago?
Yeah, 14 years ago.
Oh, 14 years, wow.
In November, last November.
Oh.
So, yeah, we had kind of an anniversary on that.
And one. The hurt never gets any less, does it?
It does. Her memory's alive every day. I think of her every single day. And I really think about her when I go cooking in the kitchen. And I hear this voice, honey, keep the heat down, don't burn my pans.
How to take care of those pans. That's so funny. Well, I really like your title, because this is also a scripture that my husband's grandmother always loved. It was her favorite scripture that she quoted. And she believed in that, and she lived by that too. And you're a man who lives by those principles as well.
Yes, that's awesome. And the reason for writing the book, not just to tell the story or pump up us, but basically to let people know that believers, especially Christians, that they need to be sharing the Lord. They're missing out on some of the greatest joy and happiness you could ever have in your life. We call ourselves, brother in Sacramento and I, who does this, we call ourselves spiritual paramedics. Because we see people brought back to life. Can you imagine how a paramedic feels when he tries to, when he realizes he's got a patient that has no pulse yeah. or anything, and he's able to bring him back to life? Can you imagine the feeling you would have if you were that person?
You should tell him what you did in your past life.
I used to work for L.A. County Fire Department, and we're the father of the paramedic program. So, yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
It's exciting, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. You know what always amazed me, though, is for the amount of people that we go out to and literally treat as if they were a friend or a family member, we would get, I would say, maybe 10% would write a letter or come into the fire station for a thank you.
Mm-hmm.
That always amazed me.
Really? Huh.
It amazed you because...
I would have thought that, you know, we just saved your life. We just saved Grandma's life. Wouldn't you like to come in and see the people who
yeah,
did it?
But
absolutely.
Yes, but oftentimes I think that what happens is they're going through recovery, and by the time they get to that point, they almost feel like, well, who would I see? Yeah. Are they even going to be there?
And right? they're waking yeah. up yeah. to the fact that their yeah. insurance isn't going to repay for what they got. Yeah. It's
true,
all
true.
The same. It's a horrible
it
thing.
Is. Yeah.
Well,
it
you
is.
Know, right along those lines, we were at a place one time and doing just a tremendous job on bringing this older woman back. And the family stepped in and said, basically, what are you doing?
Mm-hmm.
And, well, isn't it obvious? I don't want you doing that. Well, I'm sorry. Do you have a do not resuscitate form that we could look at? Or, you know? And they were hot under the collar. They nice. Wanted Grandma to go. And
oh,
why?
Oh,
I don't
my.
Know. Oh, yeah.
Well,
so I like it could be multiple, things. You know, who knows? But, yeah, I mean, it was ugly.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
it really was. We did our best still to save her.
Yep. You had a job to do, and I'm sure Harold, too, feels like, well, he may not be appreciated, but he has to fulfill his mission.
Oh, you know what? I don't want my reward here. I am stocking up in heaven.
You know,
well, Jesus spoke about treasures in heaven.
Back up the truck here. Maybe your reward is being here with us.
Oh!
Maybe.
No. Whoever saw that one.
No, that
can't be it. Can't be it. No. Watch out. These guys are persuasive.
Yeah, we're kind of tricky. We're a team.
Yeah, see.
Well, no, that didn't come out.
They got the good cop. They have the good cop, bad cop thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Which one is which? I'm not sure.
You know, I mean, think all of the people that are listening to you. I mean, that has to be a reward to you.
Oh, that is. That
so,
is.
How do I do the backstroke here?
I don't know. Try it out.
Yeah.
So Harold, tell us who you feel is the best person to read your book. I know everyone, but tell me now everyone else.
Well, Let me share this with you. I was watching YouTube the other day, and there was a preacher on, and he was from a mega church of 5,000 people that he actually developed. And I was listening to his last sermon that he was never again going to preach in that church. He said, I was so taken by all these people that every week it just boosted up my pride to think about when there was people out there in the world that need to hear about Jesus Christ. And he said, I and my family are going to China. And we're going just to teach people about the Lord. No more mega churches.
Hmm.
And so that hit me. And then there was a girl. I'll answer your question in a minute.
I know you will. I know you get around to it. We've had enough conversations. I know you'll get there.
There was a girl that sang the song, Have I Done Enough with the Time That You've Given Me. It's a very compelling hymn. And she would sing songs like When I'm Gone. I said, what's she doing? The next thing I know, she's got cancer. 42 years old.
Wow. Bummer.
And then she's gone. I can't even listen to it. They have a lot of her music still on YouTube, but I cannot look at it. It just tears me up. Have I done enough in a time that you gave me? That's compelling to me.
Jim Dobson with Focus on the Family, one of the things that he would always say is that what he would like to hear when he is there is, well done, my good and faithful servant.
I would say amen.
Yeah. So
I want.
Yep.
Yeah. That's my reward.
Yes. It'd have to be, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I have some work to do.
We all do. And on that note, I want to remind everybody that they can get a copy of In All Thy Ways Going It Alone, Volume 2, on Amazon.com, because Volume 1 is getting redone, and we will have that out shortly, hopefully. And then I believe you have a third book coming out after this.
And a fourth, and a fifth.
Good for you.
You're not through with me yet. The next one is because of the magnitude now in our society for having sociopaths. And I have one in my family, and so I had to do the research.
And we are going to have Harold back with that book when it's done. And we have to take a break, Harold. Sorry. But stay with us. We'll be back after these words. Sorry about that.
That's okay. I'd like
you gave me a pause, so I had to take it.
I'd like to tell another story. There's a lot of them, of course. Or we couldn't go through the whole book. But about working in San Quentin as a chaplain.
Oh, jeez. That had to be interesting.
And it was one-on-one going in the cell block. And I would walk to the top cell block and the top tier, and I never got to the bottom one. So this one day I said, I'm going to start out at number one cell. And so you can tell me if I can tell this on there. And so I walk up to the cell, and I said, good evening, Bill. They have their names out on the outside. And they're locked down, so you can feel pretty safe and pretty bold. He was laying on his bunk, and he was tattooed everywhere you could see. All he had was his shorts on. He was a bodybuilder. So he said, I said, how are you doing? He said, I'm doing great. Three meals a day, exercise room, TV. He said, it can't get any better. So what is it you want? And I said, well, I came in to share the Lord with you, if you let me. Is it okay I keep going?
For now, yep. We're not ready to go back
okay.
yet.
Okay, and so he said, I'm not interested. That's for women and children.
Oh.
Religion's for women and children. And I said, well, you're probably not man enough anyway to be a Christian.
Ooh. Ooh.
I must have had a bad day that day.
Yeah. I'm glad there were there were guards around, too.
Oh,
were
yeah.
Were you talking through the bars?
Yep.
Good.
But he got up off his bed. He said, let me come out there. He was a trustee, and the door was not locked.
Oh. Oh.
And I said, Lord, I'm coming home.
Yeah. Prepare a place.
And so he said, come over here to the picnic table. I want to talk to you. Nobody's ever talked to me like that. I want to hear what you have to say.
Wow.
Well, that's good.
That's a good story.
Is it? Stand by.
Yeah.
Here we go.
We're not going to have time in this segment, though, because we got the our book blitz.
Okay.
You'll enjoy this.
Okay.
It's fun.
All right.
You may even want to share a book.
Well, anyway, you got it.
We got the story.
So it's been an interesting life. What's this?
This is my tablet. That's the book I'm going to share.
Oh, cool.
Well, you guys are so tame today.
We're tame.
You're tame.
Well, we're
music's on. You're just sitting here.
Well, I don't know. Maybe it's the weather.
Yeah.
Yeah. How come Ed's not doing his?
These guys always
turn your mic on.
Those guys always accuse me of being a wild man. Look at them. They get worked up into a frizz over there.
Yeah.
Welcome back. This is What's the Story, and it is time for the Book Blitz, where we share with you books that we recommend that you would read, or maybe books that we would like to read and think maybe you might too. And so I'm just going to get started right off the top. Do you have something? No, are we going here? Okay,
am I first?
Here?
Okay, cool. All right, well, all right. A little quick story here. My husband, first thing in the morning, he wants to talk about the world situation and global economy,
yes.
And we're all going to one world financial thing, and I haven't had a cup of coffee. I don't know what he's talking about. And so I said, what do you read so I can read the same thing so I know what you're talking
right.
about. So he recommended to me a website that he likes to follow, and I did too. So I thought, okay, I'll check this out. Some of it's really quite over my head.
But only for now.
But I'm trying. And so one of these books that I am reading, I'm going to read, I'm going to get it on Kindle, and I'm going to add the audio to it because I really want to do my research on it, is The Big Short by Michael.
Oh,
yes.
I have read that. I've seen the movie.
So
yes.
This is the real story of how the crash began.
Yes.
And it is about the bond and real estate derivative markets. And there was this little, nobody knew who they were, three different groups of guys who kind of predicted what was going to happen. Nobody believed them, and they
I remember that.
They understood what might happen. They had foresight, and they invested, and they made a killing, I believe. Well, this is the story of how it all started. But who wasn't affected in 2008 by this? I think we all were, and I'd like to know a little bit of this history. So this is Michael Lewis, The Big Short.
Awesome. Great book. Great book. Can I go next?
Yes.
Oh, thanks, boss.
See, he is alive.
See how she set me up for that? See how she set me up for that?
All right. My choice today is Diary of a Wimpy Kid, Wrecking Ball. Could be any of the Diary of a Wimpy Kids. If you have a child, and this is my grandson, not my granddaughters. This is my grandson, loves the Diary of a Wimpy Kid series.
Yep.
And so I highly recommend that if you have kids, grandkids, whatever, maybe struggling with getting them to read something, I think that they'll read this, because I do not believe that my grandson is like the big reader. I think that he has, well, you know what I mean? Some kids like to read all the time.
No, that's true.
And other kids are selective.
You have to trick them into
right?
it.
Right? Yeah, or they're selective. They have certain things that they really gravitate toward. So when I saw him doing this, I mean, he wants the whole series. I said, okay, tell me what you're missing. We'll fill in the blanks, right?
So, it's funny. I know my daughter learned to read on Harry Potter.
Exactly. Well, I know people that read, like, sports magazines, you know, adults that I've met that said the only reason they read is because they read sports magazines. So I say, if you find something that a child likes, get them to read it, as long as, you know, healthy and good for them. But, you know, so anyway, Diary of a Wimpy Kid, Wrecking Ball.
That's
by
another
Jeff
show.
Kinney.
That
yeah, that's a whole nother.
Sounds fun.
Yeah, it is. It is. And so there you go. Oh, you're ready now.
I am.
Are you ready,
I just,
sir? All right. Well, after you.
This will fit right in.
Right. Stocks and wrecking balls and what else.
It was a perfect segue, wasn't it?
It's called The Christmas Wish. Now, how that fits, I don't know. That was called a pivot, you know?
Okay. We'll take it.
This is by Laurie Everett. And long ago, a little brave girl named Anja wanted to be one of Santa's elves.
Oh, okay.
So she leaves a note for her family and helps an elderly neighbor prepare for the holiday. Then she straps on her skis and heads out onto the snowy landscape. From a red bird to a polar bear to a reindeer, the menagerie of winter animals helped Anja make it her way to Santa. The large-size matted cover, extraordinary photographs, and the foiled title makes this special book for the holiday season.
Great.
Oh, that, and
that
I kept it under
choice.
A minute, huh?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
Good I
job.
Wasn't timing you.
No.
But I can next time.
I can't think of children's books anymore without wondering about the illustrators and if they're all tattoo artists.
That's true. Yeah. Or if they have that leaning,
from
right?
From our guest last week, Mary Randall with her illustrator.
Yeah. You're up.
So my book.
What wonderful choice did you make this weekend?
So growing up, my mom and dad had an album. It was a Bing Crosby album, How Lovely is Christmas? And it has a folk tale in it, you know, with Johnny Appleseed and Jim Bowie.
Oh, yeah.
And it tells the tale, right? It's a folk tale. And Bing Crosby and Jimmy Durante's in it, and it just brings a tear to my eye. And Fox and I listened to it, and it is just really special. I even looked it up. It's on YouTube, so people can listen to it. But classic folks, classic story, tearjerker.
Was that the skinniest Santa Claus you ever saw walk by? I just thought it.
We missed
it. I thought
it.
Doug saw it.
Wonder if it was in the window.
Well, when he comes back.
He must have been so thin I didn't see him.
I know.
He was probably driving in a BMW.
So tell us, what are we finding? So if I want to look for that, what am I looking for?
Bing Crosby, How Lovely is Christmas.
How Lovely
now,
is
just
Christmas,
who
okay.
was Bing Crosby?
Oh, ha, 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 ha. You're such a funny man.
Isn't
it's
Bing
going
Crosby's?
Back quite a ways.
If you look up Christmas in a dictionary, it probably has Bing Crosby.
I watched a Christmas special last night with John Legend, and he talked about how Bing Crosby was his inspiration. So it's not that far fetched. I think that, especially musicians. And, you know, artists of that type, they really warm up to all the, you know.
Well, when I knew who Burl Ives was when I was a kid because he sang all these kids' songs. And
that's right.
But probably not a lot of people know who he is.
But they know because, just like you, for the fact that they sing those kinds of songs.
And I have to thank the cartoons, like
It's getting cold.
I knew more about classical music thanks to Bugs
Bunny. I know it. I was thinking about that yesterday. It's very true.
But that was extreme wisdom and creation on the part of the creators of those shows.
Yes.
And now that they're all cut up and they have less impact.
Yeah, that's true.
But wildly stuff. Yes. That's where I learned my classic stuff.
That's what I was going to say. Classical music, I never would have listened to it. But for the fact that you heard it when you were a child in different cartoons and things, and
Warner Brothers
and then,
or something,
and then you hear it later, and you're like, oh, I really like that, right?
Yeah.
And I never would have taken the time. You know, you would have said classical.
Right.
I guess I'm not very sophisticated, right?
Find the rabbits. Find the rabbit.
Yeah, there was quite a bit of history thrown in, too. Like, you know, if you didn't know it.
Well, we should ask our guest, though. I didn't prepare you. Do you have a book you want to share that you would want to read? You don't have to, but I thought we have a couple minutes. So if you have something you'd like to
How
push
unique
out there,
is this?
I know.
Isn't that
we
something?
Actually have time, and we all did a book. That's unusual.
It was a blitz.
It really was. Wow. What a great way to end the year. By the way, we're not coming back next week, so everybody knows that we're...
Why? Wait a minute. Come on. Oh.
The collective sigh.
But I have all the
radio
together. I know. So. Save it for after the first.
Oh, sure.
Oh, sure.
I would... I would encourage people to read the Bible because
it I knew that was coming.
Yeah, of course. It had to come, didn't
That's
it?
That's right.
Because it never gets old.
Yep.
That you cannot exhaust reading the Bible.
Well, and what I would add to that is it doesn't matter if you're a, quote, religious person or not. It's something that you can read and absorb and learn from, no matter where you're coming from that perspective.
Oh, it's changed my life so many times. It's just unbelievable.
Well, principles never go out of style.
There you go.
Yeah, it won't.
There you go. Yeah. So.
I'll have to think about another book.
That's okay. We're good. So, New Year's plans, everybody? Anyone? Nothing big going on? I do family.
Snowball rolling downhill, right?
That's right.
I'm going to Pasadena.
Oh, are you going to
where?
The Rose
I'm going
Bowl?
To Pasadena. I'm going to see the Rose Parade.
Woo-hoo.
Yeah.
Ooh.
The only Rose Parade.
We lived close to it when we were growing up.
Really?
Well, I lived close enough where I could walk to it.
No, I didn't live that close.
No. Yeah.
The only Rose Parade I went to, ironically, was the one that Three Dog Night was in.
Really?
I am not kidding you. It's the only Rose Parade I went to, and Three Dog Night was there. And now I'm doing a book with.
So you got a psychic connection with Bobby Joe?
No, not with Bobby Joe. With Floyd Sneed.
Oh, with Floyd. Yeah. My bad.
It's all right. But without Bobby Joe, wouldn't have been there.
My dad would take me, my uncle, we all just went to it.
Yeah.
It was a real big deal in my family.
You have to see it at least once. Yeah, it was great. It was great, except it was really cold.
Yeah, for California.
And sitting on the sidewalk, freezing was not fun.
I don't remember being cold, but maybe because I was a kid.
Oh, man. We sat there all night so we could get a good spot.
I loved when the horses came
Oh, you
came
did
by.
That,
yeah.
huh?
Oh, yeah. Oh, my.
Oh, no, we didn't do that.
I did. Oh,
you know, that with the first, that it comes with all kinds of weather, though. It could be warm,
it does.
Too.
Yeah, that's right. All right. Yeah. This is our... oh, no, this isn't. We'll be right back.
What day is it?
I don't know. We'll be right back. This what's the story.
I was thinking
we were at the last.
My whole schedule got reversed today, so I'm really out of sorts myself.
Yeah.
And then that.
Well, and I was here at noon doing a show with Eddie, which was really nice of him to invite us. He had me and Basil come on, so.
Good.
That was nice.
Good.
Yeah.
Growing his footprint.
Yeah, sounds like exciting stuff.
You were
on
talking
the
about programs for your kids and this and that. When both my boys were young, there was I wanted to get a DVD that really, when I saw it as a kid, I thought, oh, this is great. It was called Mike Fink and the Riverboat Pirates.
Hmm.
It was a Disney movie, and
I know it.
And it starred Fess Parker. Well, so a rainy day, I said, hey, let's go down and get that. I put it in. Well, quite a gap between me and kids. Yeah. It was terrible. I mean, they showed this fight, and all they did was swing at each other a couple times, and then they fell behind a bush. And then you could see actually a rope coming out of the bush and somebody shaking the bush.
Oh, you're kidding me. That's so funny. Because we, as kids, we build up something of these things, and they're so nostalgic to us that we want to relive them. And then when we watch them again, you're like, what the heck was I thinking? Why do I even like this?
I don't think my boys got through it. I mean, it was that bad.
Oh, no, it'll get better.
I always think of those old, like Jason and the Argonauts.
Yeah.
You know? movie and the giant.
They're really bonding, aren't they?
And the crazy little skeletons fighting.
In a unique kind of way, you know. You guys are so funny, right? So, first of all,
I could be his daughter.
Memories never hold up to the real thing. They're always so much better,
but
right?
The memories, that's a good thing, though.
Yeah.
That's a real good thing.
I like to the just remember what you loved about it, but don't watch it again.
Yeah, you cut out all the bad stuff and
we soften the memory.
Purge all of that.
Yeah.
You know, that's the thing about the mind, it only remembers what it wants to.
Yeah.
Oh, that's not true though.
It eats the meat and
you probably remember more than you want to.
I know. Isn't that the truth? And it always comes about maybe 3-4 in the morning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it spits out the bones and eats the meat.
Yeah, that's like they say, that's when all your troubles go by in boxcars. Just one right after the other.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And then it's time to get up.
Yep. Ed, look, he's like a buzzard on a wire over there.
I know, he's thinking, that's a good description. You're a writer or something.
You guys who like, when I go to sleep, right, it's just dark.
I know.
Right? I wake up, it's white.
I like that. That's awesome.
Like, cool.
I
right?
have that kind of night. Last night.
That's me too. My husband gets very upset.
Everybody stand by. Here we go.
Well, I look at some of the tags, time tags. 12, 1 o'clock in the morning for you, typing.
That's Hawaii time.
Welcome back. You are listening to What's the Story? Sleep patterns are interesting sometimes. We were talking off air about
and
sleep
when
patterns.
You don't get enough sleep, it's pretty obvious.
It can be, right?
Yeah.
Anyway, yes, this is time.
My dear Jan.
It is time for Reno Gal
Okay,
Sass.
Good.
Woohoo. We missed you last week. And
a little bit. I can be brief because if you things you want to
tie you just
in.
Take your time.
Okay,
we can
sort of
chit-chat after.
Well, this sort of, I'll say what I say and we'll see what we have left over. Because, you know, these guys like to jump in here. I don't think they'll have too many bad opinions about this one. But
Virginia Lake today?
No Virginia Lake. No buzzards, no birds, no geese, no ducks. Today, I was thinking about a bit of history, of Reno history, and I don't know if we've mentioned it before, but the Granny House, which is an old home located on Plumas and Arlington and Mount Rose, and it was an old recording studio back in the day.
Really?
Not too distant history, the 80s and 90s, 1990s, and some big major bands recorded there. So we have... I think Whitesnake might have.
Really?
And Whitewater. I read something a couple of years ago. Whitewater came out with a 30th anniversary CD, and they had done all their recording at Granny's house. And
interesting.
Yeah, although I could not find anything on Whitewater on YouTube to hear the music, so I'm not sure what they sang exactly. But also, a little strange history was the group Milli Vanilli. I don't know if anybody remembers them. And their big deal was they got exposed as hoax because they were lip syncing their music. They were hugely successful, but they did not sing a word of their own music. So everything that they awards, notoriety, they became notorious, but it was it was a big shakeup for them. Well, they came back and they wanted to do a real album with their voices, and they recorded at Granny's house. And then it became Sierra Sonic Recording Mansion. It's a really adorable Victorian old house, and it got rehabilitated as a new recording studio. And then now, currently, the Reno Collective.
Is that one?
And
is that where it is?
Yeah, the Reno Collective. I know where the Reno Collective is. At the former Granny's house, and so they have over 100 members now. They started very small, but they grew as Reno is growing. They grew too, and they have entrepreneur. They have conference rooms. Thank you, and they have
have co-working spaces.
Co-working spaces. Yeah. You can collaborate on projects. They also have recording studio there too. So I'm thinking, well, how do we become members and record an audiobook?
We don't need to. We're going to have an audio studio in my office.
That's right. Okay, so Granny's house has a bit of a Reno history, and it's a pretty cool one. And also, if you are interested in old rock bands and that kind of thing, they have a Facebook page, Granny House Facebook page.
Nice.
And it says for history lovers only, but I think if you love old rock bands and stuff, you could go there too. I went there, so and I don't know anything about it. And I feel like there's something else I wanted to say about it, but I can't remember. So
who was the recording group that were stubbing all it? What was her name?
Milli Vanilli did an album there to bring their reputation back, and a bunch of other people did. Whitewater was one who I'm not familiar.
Oh, you mean there was more than one that did that?
No.
Oh. Just
no.
Other bands and
that recorded at that particular location.
Right. Yeah. Okay.
And yeah. I read online there was some little blurb snippet from a memoir of Whitesnake that they went to Hedeton, Reno, Nevada to record at Granny's house in Reno. So, and I'm sure that there were other famous bands that did it too, but those are the ones I came up with real quick. Plus, I don't have any of my material with me, but this is all in my blog, Reno Gal Says, so that blog will be soon.
Yay.
And connecting with this episode.
Yeah, really nice. Milli Vanilli should have learned from the Chipmunks that you can't lip sync.
That's true. That's one
of your favorite groups?
No.
Chipmunks?
No, but one I remember.
Who can forget?
Yes.
Right?
Yes. If you've had children, it's indelible.
Yeah. Yeah. And like it or not.
And I have some links. I'll have some links on the blog of this material where I got some of this information from, too. And hopefully I could swing by and take a picture of Granny's house. I should have done it by now. But
that's cool.
But I see it a lot. I always pass it. It's a cool old house.
Yeah. I know. I'm going to have to go by there. Check that out. Yeah. That's very cool.
It's got a cool roof job. Because it's got the turrets and stuff, and so the roof's custom asphalt.
Yeah,
makes it look really cool.
There are a lot of houses in Reno.
That's the old Southwest, the Historic Reno Preservation Society. Yeah.
Do you still belong?
Yeah, I do. Although I'm not I don't do the tours.
Okay,
I'm not
doing
a docent. Well, okay, so I got kind of shanghaied into that because I had a question, believe it or not, I had a question about the boxer.
What's his name?
I remember you did an article on him, and I can't remember the name now. It escapes me completely.
Flew out of my head. But it was in The Godfather, and he was this boxer from the 1930s, and there was some rumor that he had a home here in Reno. And so I was doing some research to find out if this boxer did indeed have a home here in Reno. So they directed me to a lady, Aunt Simone, another one, and they said, oh yeah, he definitely did, it's on our tour, he lived off of Manor, and so come. So as I was asking her questions about this home and the history, it was like, gee, you know, we're getting up in age, we need someone to take over our tours, how about you, you're it, you do it, here's here, meet us at 10 a.m. on Saturday, you're doing it. And so I was walking around. But I don't know history. I'm just trying to learn myself. And you want me to lead 30 people through this neighborhood?
So that is such an awesome space. What you need to do now is go through the ghosts of Reno.
I think there's
a tour. You could
for
do
that.
The ghosts.
There's a literary tour. There's
there you
a,
go.
Right.
I think that's your space.
There's a prohibition tour.
Oh, that one would be fun.
Yeah. I learned a lot.
One of my
grandfathers had a speakeasy during the when they were in Wisconsin.
Really?
Well, the neat thing is they come out with a little news magazine, and I learned about this. So what they did during the Prohibition was they got all the grapes and concentrated them in bricks, and then they would have to add alcohol to it to distill it. And so that was one way they did, and they were able to move all these like grape bricks. Around and not get
great
bricks. Thrown into
prison. Sounds really appetizing.
No, yeah. I think it was horrible.
You know what? I think I'll have a Merlot brick tonight.
I think it tasted pretty bad.
You know what? Does that go with fish?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Exactly. Exactly. So what were you going to say, Doug?
I was going to say you didn't know anything about it, so how are you going to talk? Let Ed and I be an example for you. We know lots about nothing and doesn't keep us all
back. I need you guys on the tour.
Doug is so right. Knowledge never stopped us from talking.
That's right. That's our strong suit.
Some of these homes in the Old Southwest are so fascinating. One of the homes was built in 1938, and it was like a time machine. Nothing had been changed, from the light switch to the grout and the bathroom tile, and it was all perfectly in good condition. It was such a beautiful home to walk through.
So it's not old.
Yeah, 1930. Oh, and then I did one on the Sequoia. The Sequoia's over there. That Old Southwest is just, so much history. I love it. Have you been in Reno your whole life?
You're kidding.
You probably grew up with that Sequoia.
Reno's not that old.
Oh, it's young. It's very young, Howard.
No, I've only been here for about 15, 16 years.
Okay.
Oh, that's a long time.
I'm a California transplant.
Okay.
Whereabouts
along
in California?
With the rest of us.
Alameda.
Yeah,
Alameda.
We're all California. Mm-hmm.
So see, that's we're transplants also.
Mm. So. Notice how he says they are, but he doesn't.
Oh, you know,
Jan is from Pasadena.
Jan,
too.
I apologize for that. You're right.
She's one of those nice Pasadena girls.
Yeah.
Actually, Glendale is where I was born. Well, and then I lived in the West Valley. Me too. I was born in Glendale as well. I grew up in the Valley. I'm a Valley girl. Me too.
A Valley girl.
Valley girl before there were Valley girls. I didn't even know. I didn't know we were a thing. I didn't either until after. Yeah.
I moved here from Alameda to get away from the traffic because it's so bad there. How bad is it? It is so bad that if you have a car parked in the front of your house and you move it within 2 seconds, it's replaced and you won't get it back for weeks.
Wow.
That's amazing.
There you go.
Oh, it's changed. It's a lot better now.
Is it?
I think it's worse.
Because I left.
I'm pretty sure it's worse. Well, there's one less person there, so you know.
Yeah.
Seemed to me like people coming this way used to have cases of oranges. Now they don't even have that, right? They got nothing.
Not anymore.
They don't have any more oranges.
Harold, they got rid of all the orange growth. We enjoyed having you with us today. Thank you so much for coming and sharing your book and all thy ways, Going It Alone. We'll have you on again.
With Volume 1.
Yes, with Volume 1 and also with your next book and
volume
your next
3
book,
and the next and the next.
He's saying, have I done all I can? Such a good question for all of us.
You might as well just hire me. And then
There you go.
Well, I don't know if you can handle these high-priced wages.
Yeah.
Right, man? You get, like, the government takes like almost all of it.
That's right.
Oh.
Well, didn't you get your wages doubled?
I did.
Yeah, see, there
you
go.
And April leaves us at the break. You're leaving us, I take
yes.
it. Yes. So I want to say Happy New Year to you.
Well, I will be back
in 2020.
Yeah, in 2020, and we'll have great.
We'll have some 2020 hindsight.
2020.
Nice. I was going to say we don't have to worry about subject matter for the next hour either.
since we're going into 2020, I want to let everybody know that 2020 will be LeRue's 20 years in publishing, not as LeRue, but we've been publishing for 20 years.
Wow.
And I said, I'm not that old.
That's an achievement.
2020 doesn't seem like the year of focus.
Yeah.
Right?
The year of
focus. Oh, that's good.
Right?
I see what you mean.
Oh, my goodness. All the puns. Yes, we're glad the year is ending. We're going to start anew.
He didn't say much today, but that was awesome.
I never say anything.
All right, we'll be right back. This is our long break. Stay with us. We'll be back after the news.
As humans, we ask ourselves all kinds of questions. But what if we were forced to ask ourselves a question every day that affected the outcome of the most basic things, the most important things in our lives? The question is, what is your sexual orientation or gender identity? And the answer is the difference between keeping your job or getting fired. The answer is the difference between staying in your home or getting evicted. The answer is the difference between receiving medical treatment or not. Because in 31 states, it's legal to discriminate against people based on their answer to this question. LGBT Americans have the right to say, I do, but they don't have the same basic rights as everyone else. Get the facts at beyondido.org. Brought to you by the Gill Foundation and the Ad Council.
Hey, Dr. Phil here. I help people solve difficult and trying personal problems every day on my TV show, but there's one problem that's just got me stumped. Childhood hunger. Nearly 16 million children in America struggle with it. That's one in five kids who may not know where their next meal is coming from, despite the fact that there's more than enough healthy, nutritious food out there to feed them all. Now, I don't know about you, but that is unacceptable to me. Luckily, the Feeding America network of good people is out there collecting surplus food and giving hope to hungry children and their families at local food banks all across the country. But let's face it, they can't do it without your help. Join me in supporting Feeding America and your local food bank at feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council. Together, we can solve hunger. Together, we're Feeding America.
This is America Matters Media Radio, heard worldwide on the web at americamatters.us and on KCKQ 1180 AM, Reno.
Breaking news this hour from townhall.com. I'm Keith Peters. With talks between the U.S. and North Korea at a stalemate, North Korea has been warning about an upcoming Christmas gift.
That so-called Christmas gift, says Heritage Foundation's Asia expert Bruce Klingner, could be an intercontinental ballistic missile test.
They could jump right to that or a nuclear test, but it's also possible they may sort of go more incrementally up the escalation ladder by doing medium-range tests, intermediate-range missile tests, a space launch vehicle, which is sort of a civilian version of an ICBM, before they jump to the ICBM.
And it may not be on Christmas.
We're looking to the annual New Year's Day speech by the North Korean leader for further clues. So I think there may be an overfixation on the phrase Christmas present. I think it was more rhetorical than literal.
Shelley Antler, Washington.
Boeing CEO Dennis Muilenburger is out today in the wake of problems with the Boeing 737 MAX jet. Correspondent Mike Kempen reports Boeing's board says a change in leadership is needed.
Dennis Muilenburger's resignation as CEO follows Boeing's announcement last week that it would halt production of the 737 MAX in January. United Airlines then said it's pulling the 737 MAX from its flight schedule until June. And that same day, Spirit AeroSystems, which manufactures fuselages, said it would end deliveries intended for the MAX in January.
Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell says he is not ruling out witnesses in President Donald Trump's impeachment trial, but indicated he was in no hurry to seek new testimony either. Lawmakers on Monday remained at an impasse in the form of a trial by the GOP-controlled Senate after the Democrat-controlled House voted Wednesday to impeach Trump. McConnell says he wants the Senate to adopt rules like those used in the 1999 Clinton impeachment trial. On Wall Street, the Dow by 96 points, the NASDAQ rose 20. More on these stories at townhall.com.
Sebastian Gorka here. Maybe you've been hearing about Relief Factor, the 100% drug-free supplement that helps a person's body deal with inflammation and pain. You've heard all the wonderful testimonials. Well, I have my own testimonial. For many years, my lower back pain was becoming a serious problem. The short story is, I finally gave it a try, and now I'm out of pain too. So if you're in pain, you can order the 3-week quick start for just $19.95. Go to relieffactor.com.
This Wednesday,
they convicted an innocent man.
Michael B. Jordan.
Your life is still meaningful, and I'm going to do everything possible to keep them from taking it.
Academy Award winner Jamie Foxx.
You don't know what it is down here when you're guilty from the moment you're born.
And Academy Award winner Brie Larson.
I don't want my son growing up knowing that his mom stopped doing what was right just because she was scared of him.
You ain't quitting, is you?
No, sir. Just Mercy, rated PG-13. May be inappropriate for children under 13. In select theaters Wednesday, everywhere January 10th. Directed by Destin Daniel Cretton.
Here's the townhall.com business brief.
Sears says it sold the diehard car battery brand to Advance Auto Parts for $200 million as the struggling retailer seeks to raise cash. Sears will still be able to sell diehard goods in its stores. Orders to U.S. factories for big-ticket manufactured goods fell 2% in November. The drop was led by a large decrease in orders for defense aircraft and parts. The Commerce Department says the drop in orders for durable goods last month was the biggest decline since May. Stocks closing higher on Wall Street, lifting the market's major indexes to new record highs. The Dow gained 96 points today to 28,551. The NASDAQ ahead 20 to 8,945. The S&P was up 2 points to 3,224. New York oil picked up 26 cents to $60.70 a barrel. With business, I'm John Scott.
News and analysis at townhall.com. I'm Keith Peters. Today we look at this year's top stories on Capitol Hill. We hear more from Bernie Bennett.
Impeachment was a word most often mentioned in this year's congressional record. The Democrat-controlled House impeached the sitting president for the third time in U.S. history. The House held closed-door and public hearings on impeachment that took up most of the fall. Earlier in the year, they held many hearings on the Mueller report. They also passed a major spending bill, avoiding a government shutdown and increasing pay for the military, as well as restricting pro-abortion activities in many states. The bill included $25 million to study gun violence in America. They passed the USMCA, a major trade deal between the U.S., Mexico, and Canada. Trade with China was also a much-debated issue. And the House lost members this year through retirement, resignation, and the passing of some members. This year will be remembered for a Congress more divided than ever.
Tomorrow, our Senate correspondent Bob Agnew has more 2019 events on Capitol Hill. More on these stories at townhall.com.
The following is an America Matters Media production. The views expressed do not necessarily represent those of the station or its advertisers, although we think they should. But that's the opinion of America Matters Media.
Stories we've told, stories we've told, stories we've told, seven at a time. Stories we've told, stories we've told, stories we've told, till the end of time. Oh, said someone right.
Welcome back. This is What's the Story. This is the second hour of What's the Story. It always goes so quickly.
Wow, that was just like a radio show party, wasn't it? That was kind of wild.
We made up for being quiet for the first part, didn't we?
Oh, you guys weren't quiet.
Quiet? Oh, I just got here.
That's right.
You guys.
Hey, now, look, we're red, red, blue. We probably should have switched. We should
no
have
kid. Well, look, Mr. Expressive.
Yeah, I know.
He's glowing on there.
You know, I'm red and black. You know, he's red and black, but he's bright with some white in there that makes it look great.
Red, white, and blue.
Blue, that's right.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that's all about personality, right?
Well, you know, personalities and focus, right? I was kind of playing with 2020 being the year of focus, but
or lack of.
Well, right. So, right, in different frequencies as we grow our business, and, you know, I'll go to you because you have facets, right? So, is 2 plus 2, 4? Is 2 plus 2, 3? Is 2 plus 2, 5?
If you're a politician, 2 plus 2 is whatever you want to make it.
Well, well, in the business world, right, or teamwork, you want to synergize, right? And the sum of your parts should add up to greater, right, than what they add up to. And so I think we want to take segments of our business. So there's 2 points, there's 2 points, there's 2 points, and they add up to 7.
Well, and just to add to that, sometimes it's 2 minus 1
right
actually equals 2. Because sometimes you want to, I know.
No, that's where exactly where we're going. Yeah, because if something needs to be 2 and it's a 1 or a negative 1, guess what? We got to sweep that baby away.
That's right.
Or sell and morph it.
Oh, man.
Right? Yeah. Because you only want to be in the productive space.
That's right.
Right? And all business people.
So you didn't think 2 minus 1 could equal 2.
No, it's been on this side of the table. This is, my goodness, I didn't realize.
Hold it. Watch out. Right, we got the mind blow.
Yeah, my head's going to catch on fire here.
But segments of our business, for instance, like this radio show, right? I mean, to me.
Are we on a radio show?
What? Huh? What? No, for me, this is like awesome. I think we reach really smart folks, right? I think our listener group, however wonderful they are, and we certainly like to pile them on, but they're smarter than the average bear, right? They're good listeners. They're intelligent folks. And I think when smart folks, right, sometimes we look at stuff and, you know, I'm divorced, so sometimes you look at stuff wrong.
Well, probably according to your ex-wife, yeah.
But if I look at stuff right and have a partner check it, right, and look at it and go, wow, you know what? This energy I'm spending over here really isn't helping anyone. It's just wasting my time.
Yeah.
Well, right. And it's one of the things I really do like about year ends and year beginnings is the fact that you are almost forced to reevaluate.
Totally agree.
You're forced to kind of, whether you want to or not.
Right.
And some years I don't particularly like looking back or even looking forward. I just want to keep going. But it really does make you evaluate. And it's good for a business to do that, even, you know, when you don't feel like it.
It is, but you don't want to dwell backwards. As long as you've
only
changed,
to learn.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Past learning, it's a worthless endeavor. Looking forward, right? I got to say, for me, this is, you know, I've been on plan, right? I didn't hire as many loan folks as I thought, right? But other than that, I achieved virtually most of my goals.
I was going to say, but did it matter that you didn't?
So it will this year, right?
Okay.
So plan two, right, is I prefer those folks who are up and going now versus having to get them up and going, though I do have two, you know, on the hook.
So to speak.
So, yeah, I haven't reeled them in yet, but we'll see.
Christian, we were talking fishing earlier. I think he's in our world of fishing, right?
Oh, fishing? Is that what we were talking about? Oh, ice fishing.
Oh, maybe. Yeah, I guess you could.
So, but back, I mean, another thing that drives me crazy when we look is, why don't we say more with less words? Right? Why not communicate succinctly? Why not communicate how we feel directly?
You know, that goes absolutely against my grain, because it seems like I was brought up as a storyteller, and just to say something very succinct, it never seems like I get the point across.
Seems to me like if you're succinct, you can say like 100 times more.
I could.
My son, right?
Think about that.
I had this discussion with my son, right? Of course, after he, like, I asked for something, he goes, looks, comes back to ask a question, goes back, comes back. It's just like 5 minutes. I'm like, what are you looking for, right? Ask the right question.
Why? Why do you want to be succinct?
You really touched a chord with Doug.
Well, yeah. When you talk to succinct people,
I'm going
to
play that back to you. For verification.
No, they talk in word bursts, and I go, oh, well, I guess that's their style.
So, right, and people do broadcast, right? So I think you're hanging out with Jan and I, right? You're hanging out with some movers and shakers in this town here,
this
right?
Of the table.
There is no one in the Reno Town Mall movers and shakers like us today, right? So no, but the level of frequency, the higher, and Jan will tell you this, look, the higher the radio show goes, our businesses go, the level of folks we talk to is much greater. Look, there's Marvin Parker from Chase International out there. He like talks to me and stuff, right? But I mean, you go into a different space where people you talk to are trying to get stuff done too. So you don't run into the broadcasters. You run into people that want to effectively communicate.
Does that answer, Doug?
I'm not buying it, but it's an answer.
Fair enough. Well, he never buys what you say, though, so that's okay.
I get it, but I'm kind of speechless on that one.
Yeah.
Can I tell you? You'll have to address that after the first of the year, and we'll plan a good show for the first.
Yeah, now that I've taken my sign vertical, we're all in.
We're all in. There you go. All right. All right. Well, gosh, that just was quick, but thank you very much for sharing your thoughts, as always, and your tips.
Well, wait a minute.
If he doesn't appreciate those.
Wait a minute. I think your thoughts were just real
deep.
Mediocre.
Weren't they really deep? Did you see how deep they were, man?
All right. We got to go. We'll be right back with Eddie Floyd.
The Butcher's Kitchen Charbecue invites your family in for the best wood fire, slow cooked barbecue, rotisserie, and open char pit food around these parts. Charbecue on the corner of Virginia and Huffacre presents sliced Santa Maria tri-tip, beef brisket, and ribeye. Charbecue redefines homemade pork and specialty sausages. The all-meat chili reigns supreme in Reno. Charbecue, the Butcher's Kitchen, 7689 South Virginia at Huffacre, Winter's Crossing. Get in and get real. Charbecue, Reno.
Are you planning to move? Paragon Home Resources can help you sell or buy a home anywhere in the United States. We provide a home resources coordinator to manage all aspects of your move. We recommend qualified real estate agents and other services to prepare your home for sale. Best of all, if you sell or buy a home with our assistance, you could be eligible to receive a tax-free real estate commission cash rebate. We can also help you obtain a mortgage at competitive interest rates. Our lenders offer fixed and adjustable rates, conforming and non-conforming loans, plus FHA and VA financing. We can also assist first-time buyers with as little as 5% down. And when it comes time to move, we can refer you to qualified movers or other companies to assist with self-moves. Paragon Home Resources helps make moving as easy as possible. Call Paragon Home Resources to learn more, 1-855-474-7227, or visit us at paragonhomeresources.com.
Hi, I'm Bill Kendall. I practiced law in Northern Nevada for over 25 years, and I specialize in representing injured people in their fights for just compensation and in representing parents in custody and visitation disputes. I've tried over 20 jury trials to verdict. I've arbitrated or mediated hundreds of personal injury cases on behalf of clients to successful conclusions, and I have personally handled every single case from start to finish. I am also a court-appointed mediator for the Washoe County Family Court Division, where I help parents negotiate custody and visitation plans. With me as your attorney, you can rest assured that your case will be handled competently and that I will be responsive to all of your needs and questions. My goal in every case is to have clients that are satisfied with the outcome of their case and who would recommend me to others. Give me a call at 775-324-6464. Or visit my website, BillKendallLaw.com. My number again is 775-324-6464.
The all-volunteer nonprofit assistance league, Reno Sparks, is working to improve lives in Washoe County. Annually, they provide new clothes and grooming essentials to over 3,000 children through Operation School Bell. Students in Transition addresses needs of homeless teens. Find out more by visiting their website, renosparks.assistanceleague.org. These activities are funded by Assistant League's Thrift Shop at 1701 Vassar Street, open 10 to 4 Monday through Saturday.
You're invited to join Business Connections with Anita every Wednesday from 10 to 11 a.m. here on 1180 a.m. KCKQ America Matters.
Want to expand your advertising dollar? Sponsor this or any America Matters program by calling 775-827-8900, extension 2. Now back to the show.
Welcome back. And that's that little chuckle is Doug Ashby over here having a grand old time.
Yeah. Oh, that's so much fun.
Yes, it is. And we do have fun while we're on our breaks, but we also have fun while we're on the air. And today we are doing a soft launch from LeRue of Barn Yarns. I don't know where I hold this lovely thing, but you'll be able to see it if you go online. Barn Yarns by Eddie Floyd, who is the founder of America Matters Media and is a wonderful guy and has written a wonderful book and honored us with bringing it to LeRue so that we could publish it. So we have him on the phone. He wasn't able to stay in town today, but he is on the phone with us. Welcome, Eddie Floyd.
Well, thank you very much, Jan, and I'm going to thank you again for earlier today being on our very first televised broadcast from the America Matters Media Studio right there at the Reno Town Mall.
It was fun. It was lots of fun.
It was. It was great. And you and Kelly did a phenomenal, phenomenal job with Basil the comedian. But what an honor to have our first inaugural televised show and have you do a soft, if you will, release opening for Barn Yarns. I'm so excited. Matter of fact, I brought home two copies so that Shari and our ranch manager, Michael, I've told them they've got to read it by nightfall.
They're on the clock, huh?
It's getting dark
Well, actually, they're out feeding the wild Mustangs and other horses here at the barn. But to be honest with you, I am so honored that LeRue Press, and especially this gives me one more opportunity to thank your dear mother, who's no longer with us, but for actually transcribing my longhand into book form so that LeRue Press could print it. I just owe her the world.
So do we. It was a joy that she got to do that. So, Eddie,
probably enjoyed everybody who didn't have to do it, right?
Did I say that? Wait a minute.
Well, I think so. I think that's what you might have meant.
Oh, well, maybe. So talk a little bit about Barnyarns and how it came about. And, you know, we called it Tales from the Wynema Ranch because really it's based there. So give us some background and share a little bit with our audience.
Well, I sure will. As you know, my very first attempt at being an author was a little love story called Final Breath at LeRue Press, and you also were responsible to get out. Final Breath is a love story. It tells how Hunter, as a young married man, is explaining Final Breath, the flower, to his wife, Holly. Well, Barnyarns, which is my second, if you will, book, was a follow-up. It went back in time to when Hunter, and by the way, with a couple of exceptions, the book pretty much follows the storyline in this regard. When Hunter was 3 and a half, Shari and I actually basically raised him here at the Wynema Ranch so that his mother and father could attend UNR and become a therapist today, you know, as well as a CPA. And Rudy is the therapist, Carrie is the CPA, but Hunter was a little 3 and a half year old, their first child. And he stayed here at the ranch with Shari and I. And he used to tell Shari and I how he could talk to the animals. And we've all gone through that experience with the little infants in our lives telling us that they could talk to animals. Well, the thing about Barnyarns is the fact the animals talk back. And that's what makes it a little bit different.
Well, and it's a good story, but it goes beyond that because it actually embraces the stories around the animals and what they go through when they're attacked and have to kind of protect themselves and the ranch.
Well, you know, I'm glad you brought that up, Jan, because there is a chapter in there about how Leon, okay, you know, who in the book is called Mister, you know,
mm-hmm.
how he actually gets involved with a mountain lion, when in fact Leon, our red-bone coonhound, was actually killed by mountain lions, two of them, here at the Wynema Ranch. So that's where the story came from. So it tells the story how Leon goes out and actually helps save all the other animals here at the ranch by fighting off the mountain lion. And if you'll remember how the story ends, I don't want to give away the ending of that particular chapter. But that was one of my favorite ones to write because Leon still holds a very big place in my heart in the fact that after he was gone for a couple of weeks and we didn't know where he was, a truck driver stopped at Hallelujah Junction gas station and said, hey, is Eddie's animals okay? I saw two large mountain lions 3 nights ago crossing U.S. 395 right there at his ranch road. That's where we put two and two together and realized that he may have lost his life to the mountain lions, which was then confirmed. Jan, this is out of a Walt Disney movie. It was confirmed when Shari said, look at Hooch, which is a little Australian shepherd who's no longer with us. Hooch was walking across the fields carrying something pretty big, almost too big for him to carry. And what he did was he brought the remains of Leon, which was a backbone, a tail, one front leg, okay, and the entire neck and head back to the ranch and put Leon's body in a hollowed out hole that Leon used to sleep in every day. At night, he patrolled the ranch. During the day, he slept in that little hollowed out hole, and Hooch brought his body back and put it in that hole.
Wow. That's phenomenal. It's
just and like I said, it's like a Disney movie that I actually witnessed.
And I understand that Harvey Lowry may have an interest in the book, perhaps?
Yeah, you see, Harvey Lowry wanted to, if you will, and they're still working on it, he wanted to make a film with Final Breath here at the Wynema Ranch. And if you'll remember, Michael Cutt got involved in
it
and several other people.
Yep.
Yeah, they got involved in it, and right at the last minute, the distributors and the money people couldn't see eye to eye, so it kind of was placed on the back burner, but Harvey Lowry is very interested in barnyards because he won his Oscar. He won his Oscar for Benjamin Button because one thing he's good at is makeup. Like, he also was nominated for The Mask. He was involved in The Mask, and he won the Oscar for Benjamin Button. So the fact that the animals actually talk is perfect. That's right up Harvey's alley as a director-producer.
That's awesome. So you have some advantages that many authors do not, that to have a book that you were in the process of.
I'm still looking for those advantages.
You're still looking for what?
I apologize. I stepped on you.
That's okay.
I'm still looking for those advantages. I'm still looking for them.
Oh, no, I think you have quite a few, and we appreciate everything you do for us here at What's the Story. Really appreciate the opportunity to be able to do our show, and this gives us a chance to thank you for that in person, because we don't always get to see you.
Here's the bottom line. The bottom line is, Jan, you and the rest of your co-hosts there, you have an excellent show, and I'm looking forward to 2020 when I'm going to talk to the people and make sure that What's the Story and that show, that two-hour show with Book Out, gets televised as well.
Oh, they would love that. I got a bunch of showboats here.
Wow.
I'll be hiding under the table, and they'll be on screen.
No, you guys do such a phenomenal job. And I'll tell you what, with Christian behind the control board, Kelly Rush at the helm as the new CEO for America Matters Media, I like to tell people that 2020 is going to be perfect vision for America Matters Media.
Oh, that's a great tagline. I like that.
Isn't that nice to say?
Yeah.
It's nice to hear.
It is. Yeah, it's very good. All right, so Eddie, tell us, I'm going to ask you what I ask all authors. Who's your best audience? Who are the people that are reading your book?
Well, let me tell you what. It's going to be the younger crowd and the much older crowd. I see a grandparent reading barnyards to his grandchildren, quite frankly. You know, I think that would be ideal to have grandparents and parents involved in reading barnyards to them, because sometimes, you know, when our little kids come to us and tell us things like Hunter told us he could talk to the animals, and Shari and I kind of poo-pooed the idea, but when in reality, you and I don't know what's really taking place with a young mind and a young child.
It's true. It's very true. Some people have invisible friends, right, when they're grown up. So I looked at Doug. I don't know why I looked at Doug when
Takes
I said
you.
That.
Well, you were reading my mind.
So I had one, but yeah.
Well, yeah, that's right.
You know, here's the amazing thing. I didn't have invisible friends, okay? But I know I would come home from school and my folks had moved. So, you know, it was a rough
couple.
There you go.
Well, Eddie, your book will be available on Amazon et al. So it'll be Barnes & Noble, Amazon, all the different places, and hopefully some independent bookstores as well. So we'll let you know exactly where it's going to be, but definitely available at LeRue always, and we'll make sure we make this a hit.
You know, and I look forward to having book signings with you and any of the authors that would like to join me, like we discussed today earlier.
Absolutely. Absolutely. All right. Well, thank you again for being on the show, and thank you for everything you do for us here at What's the Story on America Matters.
Hey, you know what? Merry Christmas to you and your entire crew, and Merry Christmas to all the listeners of What's the Story.
Thank you. Merry Christmas to you, too.
All right. That's it for us for this segment. We'll be right back.
Wynema Ranch Wild Horse Sanctuary, a preserve dedicated to keeping America's wild mustangs and burros running free. Wynema Ranch, 29 miles north of Reno near Hallelujah Junction, an amazing site to visit. Over 130 of God's majestic animals at home on the range. Experience the beauty and wonder. Give at WynemaRanch.com. That's Wynema Ranch.com or call 775-384-4444. Wynema Ranch.
Ready for a live game of Clue? For nearly 30 years, Funtime Theater has held private and monthly dinner murder mysteries. Each night is different, and each event includes dinner and a show. You're the detective, and your job is to figure out who did what to who and why. At the end of the night, a super sleuth and not so super sleuth are awarded prizes. This is a great event for a birthday or holiday party and team building events for your office. Visit FuntimeTheater.com to make your reservations and use promo code RADIO for $5 off each admission.
Adopt US Kids presents What to Expect When You're Expecting a Teenager, Learning the Lingo.
Today I'm going to help parents translate teen slang. Now, when a teen says something is on fleek, it's exactly like saying, that's rad. It simply means that something is awesome or cool. Another one is totes. It's exactly like saying, totally, just shorter. As in, I totes love going to the mall with Becca. Another word you might hear is jelly. Jelly is a shorter, better way to say jealous, as in, Chloe, I am like so jelly of your unicorn phone case.
You don't have to speak teen to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will think you're, rad, just the same. To learn more, visit AdoptUSKids.org. A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, AdoptUSKids, and the Ad Council.
I spend a lot of time in the garage, but even more time in the rain, sleet, and mud. In 95, I helped tow your moving trailer. In 05, I helped you get out of a ditch. Yeah, I know I'm a bit rusty, and sadly in 09, it was sparks from me, your handy chains, dragging behind your truck that accidentally started a wildfire.
Sparks from dragging chains can start a wildfire. Spark a change, not a wildfire. Visit SmokeyBear.com, brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service, your state forester, and the Ad Council.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
This is America Matters Media on AM 1180 KCKQ, a Lotus broadcast station. The power of radio since 1967.
The story of my life, I give forever. I spend her love until she's broken.
Unable to listen to the whole show? A recording of today's program will be available later today. Visit americamatters.us and click on the podcast link. Now, back to the show.
It's the Hollywood Rockin' Wrap-Up with your host, Jason Hadley.
The son of belated Playboy magazine founder Hugh Hefner has decided to step away from his media company to enlist in the United States Air Force. Following basic training, Hefner will likely become a flight instructor, considering his family's history of encouraging one hand on the joystick at all times. The actress from the controversial Peloton ad that recently went viral has seen a boost in her career, recently landing a gig on the daytime soap opera The Bold and the Beautiful. The husband was the far better actor, convincing his already skinny wife that she needed an exercise bike. MTV Teen Mom turned porn star Farrah Abraham announced that she recently underwent vaginal rejuvenation surgery in time for Christmas. Here's a quick clip of her doctor explaining the procedure.
The new Ultra Grip 8 Performance. Goodyear. Made to feel good.
And that's the Hollywood Rockin' Wrap-Up. Follow us on Twitter at Rockin' Wrap-Up.
Welcome back, I think.
I couldn't help it. I couldn't hold back.
Oh, my goodness. It's time for Brian T. Shirley in the BTS Entertainment Corner. Hey, Brian.
Hey, how's everybody doing up in Reno?
A little wet, but good.
Yep.
It's wet outside.
Mountain snow.
Yeah. Raining here.
It's been raining. Well, I was in Atlanta. I drove back to Charleston today, and it was nothing but cold and rainy the whole time I was there. It was nasty. Before I get to something serious I'm going to talk about later on, I'll do the entertainment part first. I want to say, give a shout out to Lori Hygby from Social Capital. And she sent me this. I did an interview on her podcast, and I got a pleasant surprise in the mail. It says, grow the relationship. And it's a quote from the podcast I did with her. And it's episode 187. And I posted it up on the What's the Story Facebook page. But you might have to scroll down to do it. So I'll try to post it again. But anyway, I just want to give her a shout out and thank her for sending me this. It's a little, you can stand it up on your desk or whatever. It's a neat little plaque.
That's cool.
Yeah, it was a pleasant surprise. The two things I'm going to cover in the entertainment side of today is, and this is all on What's the Story. So you can see this on the Facebook page. Number one, and I just sent the interview to you, Janice, with Maria Paris. She's got her, it's a web series, but she's doing a pilot for Rita Guida. That's the character. Do we have any Italian folks in the studio?
I don't think so.
Okay. Anyway.
I don't know.
Hold on. Let me poll them. Let me poll the studio audience. Well, how many, guys? How many?
Oh, look.
What
have
we
waving.
Got?
Look at a wave.
She plays a very strong Italian woman, let's say, in this series. It's a comedy series. It's called Rita Guida, and she plays a hit woman of sorts, and she uses her shoes, her stilettos or her Pradas or whatever. I don't even know all women's shoes, but it's really funny. And, you know, she plays, I think it's three or four characters in this series, and she's putting together a pilot to shop this around to, you know, studios and stuff. So I'm wishing her the best of luck. I've got the GoFundMe page up on What's the Story. And I just sent Janice Hermsen. That's right. Our number one host there.
Fearless leader. This fearless leader.
Right. I just sent you her interview for next month. And next year.
Oh, you're so early. Look at you.
Yep.
I could tell he was serious.
Only,
it's the
not
sweater.
Only can you read about it on Facebook and go to the fund, GoFundMe and support this if you want, or at least you can watch the video and you can see what it's about. But you'll be able to read all about it next month. What's the story? And I think you'll find it very interesting. And she's done some pretty good films. She was in a film called Frank and Ava, where she played Frank Sinatra Jr.'s wife, and Eric Roberts was in it. So there was some pretty big actors in this film with her, and I'll let you read the interview. I won't tell you everything, because it's really cool, and she's got some things coming up, and just read the interview next month, folks. Pick up a copy of What's the Story, or you can go online and see it on issue.com, and we got a lot of stuff coming. Me and Janice had a talk. I don't know if you made a decision on anything today, Janice. But I know we talked, and there's a lot of good things coming down.
Lots
the road
of good things going down. Yep. We're going to find a way. How about I say that? We're going to find a way.
Oh, that's amazing. well, either way, you know, the show's growing. I mean, you got Ed and a fantastic producer working behind the scenes, so you know, there's no way the show can't.
It's doing well anyway.
Right. Uh-oh. So the other thing I wanted to say is that if you're looking for something to watch, a quick film, it's I think it's 15 minutes long, and I put the link up on What's the Story's Facebook page. It's another film from Benjamin Diamond, who I've done two short films, and then we have the big film coming out next year, Mark the Butterfly. Well, he's got a film out right now. I wasn't in this one, but it's called Spirit, the Red Rider. And it actually pulls some stuff from the Bible and expands on the story of the Nephilim and the story about the sons of God going into the sons of man, you know, that whole Genesis story. And I guess he expounded on it, but I'm going to watch it tonight because, folks, it's out right now. It just came out today on YouTube, so you can watch it for free. It's 15 minutes. Ed, it's got action, whatever. Watch the interview if you can, folks, and that'll explain a little more. It's what he calls guerrilla film, these little shorts he's been doing. And what that is, folks, that's really, it's just it's quick and raw. I mean, he shoots these in a day.
We need to start doing some guerrilla book trailers.
Yeah, I like guerrilla everything.
I know, guerrilla anything. It sounds good. Yeah.
Yeah, and, I mean, they're low budget, but he does a really good job.
Well, they're attention getting, right?
Yeah. I think I did, what was it, Wrong Guy, where I played a guy that got shot. And
I saw that one. I actually saw that one. Yeah. That was good. It was not good, but I mean, it was good from the standpoint. It wasn't good what happened, but it was good, you know.
Right. No, we got. I know we got about 1,100, maybe 1,200 hits on that.
Yeah, I watched it. Yeah, I watched the whole thing too. So
these are he's doing these to kind of show people what he does as a director, what the filmmaking process, and he's also building an audience for when he puts out the feature film Mark the Butterfly next year, which we've talked about on here, and that's coming down the road. He even talks about it a little bit in this video I just put out on What's the Story. I do want to say something serious real quick before we leave, because I think it's important, especially during this time of year. Obviously, I wish everybody a Merry Christmas. But I want to say that if you have relatives that are suffering from, say, depression or mental illness, this is a tough time of year for those folks. It is really a tough time of year. So just be vigilant with your friends and family. But the other part I want to say to this is if you are somebody that has someone like that in your family and you're trying to reach out to them and it's not working, and I'm saying this from personal experience, you've got to learn to let go and not let it affect your holidays too. You can only do so much for somebody in your family until it gets to the point where it's just going to ruin it for you.
You know, Brian, that goes for lots of things. You know, you talk about mental illness. You know, it's also alcoholism, drug abuse. All those things are all related and you know, similar in nature for different reasons. But yeah, it's a tough time, and it is hard to let go. But you're right. You gotta not have it hurt your space for the time being. So.
Yeah, and this is for those things you just said. This time of year, for some reason, that
just
comes
harder.
To a head.
Yeah. Well, I guess because it's supposed to be family time, and you know, you're supposed to all be together. That was sort of one of the reasons why we had Harold on today earlier in our first segment. He did a book called "In All Thy Ways, Going It Alone," and you know, it's a good thing for people who are trying to figure out, you know, because he didn't think he'd be able to make it either, you know, for other reasons. But it's still all because of this kind of time of year that it affects you.
Right. I think it magnifies any problems.
Yeah.
Any family problems, any mental problems, personal problems. For some reason, this time of year shines the magnifying glass on it. So I just thought I'd say, you go through a tough time, but then I came home and I feel better now. Let's put it that way.
Good. Well, I'm glad. And I'm glad that happened. So, and the other will work itself out. It'll work. You know?
But,
I'm an optimist.
Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you. And we're not on next week, but we'll see you after the first in 2020.
Right. Happy New Year, folks. And let's make 2020 even better than 2019, which 2019 was a pretty kick-ass year, if I must say. So let's kick some more next year.
That's right. So tell them where they can find you, Brian. You still got a couple of seconds here.
BrianTShirley.com, and I'm all over social media too. Just put in Brian T. Shirley.
If you need to network with anyone, Brian's the guy. He's a good networker, and he'll partner with you, and you help him, he helps you. It works both ways. This is What's the Story. We are going to be right back after these messages with our last segment, so please don't go away. Stick with us.
We're talking to Victor from Precision Diamonds. Victor, I don't know anything about jewelry at all. I don't know anything about diamonds. I need to get something for my lady.
Well, you know what, Jim? Come on in. We are your local jeweler, and we want to be your personal shopper. For 27 years, we know that we are doing business directly with the right manufacturers. We have negotiated great prices. They have the right trend, the right designs, quality, from earrings to pendants to you name it. We've got it.
That means you're going to help me from beginning to end.
My family, we've been working for this for a long time. I don't know how to change oil or anything, but I know diamonds. I know jewelry. So if you want to come in, you don't have to worry about anything. We'll find the exact gift that you're looking for that's going to make you look like $1 million, that you really took the time and effort to choose something, not just say, I'll take this. You know, your lady will know that you took the time and found a beautiful gift for her.
Thank you, Victor. Precision Diamonds, your local jeweler across from the convention center.
1 in 3 adults in America have prediabetes, but most don't know it. To let people know it can be reversed before it becomes type 2 diabetes, professional basketball player Julius Randle is doing everything in reverse.
I'm only dunking with reverse windmills. I drove the whole way to practice in reverse. I don't recommend it. This move's called the reverse shuffle. I do recommend it. And it took me months to learn how to speak in reverse, like this. Here's 10 almost for diabetes type 2 with living Ben has mom my. In other words, my mom has been living with type 2 diabetes for almost 10 years. So together, we want to say to the 84 million Americans at risk, exercise and healthy eating can help reverse prediabetes. Start by taking a simple 1-minute risk test at doihaveprediabetes.org.
Brought to you by the Ad Council and its prediabetes awareness partners.
Bet he can't say that in reverse.
No word in the English language is less convincing than probably.
Are you sure we should get matching tattoos on our first date?
Sure. We'll probably stay together.
Probably?
It's been 23 minutes since I ate. I can probably swim.
You should wait 30 minutes.
Okay, now tell me what to do. Cannonball! Cramp! Oh, I have a cramp.
I can probably hit the green from here. Probably. Can I get a mulligan?
Ready to go?
Hey, are you sure you're okay to drive?
Yeah, I'm pretty sober. Yeah, I'm probably okay.
Probably okay isn't okay, especially when it comes to drinking and driving. If you're drinking, call a cab, a car, or a friend. Buzz driving is drunk driving. A message brought to you by NHTSA and the Ad Council.
This is America Matters Media on AM 1180 KCKQ.
A Lotus broadcast station. The power of radio since 1967.
To join the conversation, call 844-790-TALK. That's 844-790-8255. Now back to the show.
Hey, welcome back. This is our last segment of What's the Story for 2019. Very exciting year in 2019, and I want to thank you guys for being a part of What's the Story and contributing what you contribute and putting up with stuff here and there.
Boy, you're the one who puts up with the stuff, right? I remember last year talking right about this and participating, and I really didn't think the audience had the stomach for it, but looks like it's been a wonderful, wonderful continuing experience for me. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
I usually try to take the opposite of what Ed says, but I can't. I have thoroughly enjoyed this time here, and it's been so much fun. How do you relate how much fun that you're having, other than saying I'm having a lot of fun? I mean,
so you're Ryan, such an expressive.
Wait a minute, let me do my impression of Ed.
No, like my aunt though, right? All these gifts from partners, referral partners, friends, right, are to motivate you to further greatness so you can awaken others to do great things.
He's so out there sometimes.
Did you see that? Doug was speechless. I saw it.
No,
I saw it.
I was figuring, how am I going to run to the other side of the table so I can look him in the eye and say something?
That was fun.
Sometimes we just nod and agree, huh?
Every now and then.
Yeah.
That's what
remember,
we need to
remember
do.
What I was saying? We should start calling him Uncle Ed?
Yes.
You know, this is this where you're going to, what do you got going on?
For Christmas?
No, just the segment right
now.
Oh,
for the segment? I was going to do a few trivia things or whatever. It was just sort of a kickback, do whatever.
Oh, nice.
No real super prep. I just figured, because you guys always have stuff to talk about, so I didn't worry about it. I thought last segment of the year we should just be relaxed.
I have a couple things.
Okay. You always do.
For whatever reason, I started reading about it this morning. When did Christmas start in the United States?
Oh.
What year?
Oh, do you know the answer
I
to
do.
That? Oh.
I do.
Well, let me think about
what was
about
the origin?
That. Boy, I don't know the origin. I can't say that I do.
Yeah.
I mean, I know what it should be, but...
Yeah.
Well, right. Well, it obviously wasn't then.
You know, I say Christmas. This was more related, I think, to Santa, but Santa and Christmas go along together.
Okay.
And I'll give you kind of a clue. We were kind of separating from England at the time. What year would that be? 1776, right. Well, this was in 1773, and it was the Dutch that had the influence on Old Saint Nick and, you know, and Santa Claus.
Hmm.
Well, that's interesting.
See, I thought it was the Meisterburger Burgermeister.
Now, in my wildest, my wife, 100
miles
an hour.
Let me take you 100 years later,
yeah.
1878, and the first telephone book made contained... only 50 names. Can you believe that?
50 names.
No, they were all related.
Names, exactly.
Was Santa in there?
He might have been, because, you know, they were celebrating, so there
bet
you go.
Dimes to dollars that town had a North Pole Road, right?
There you go. Yeah, I just thought that one was kind of interesting, 50 names. Because think of it today. If there was a telephone book, how many names do you think would be in it? 50 names, right? Because nobody's going to go in the phone book.
Well, you know what was interesting? It ended like this, that when it was back to Bell system and you didn't want your telephone number listed, you know, take it out.
Oh, you had to pay for it.
You had to pay for it. Now, there was a sales job.
That really was
I don't want to get something. Well, you have
so
to pay
you guys
for
crack me up. Don't you think the phone company's just like exactly the same? They just charge less now, right? They used to charge all this stuff before it was all hardware, right? So they just charge whatever they could get.
Well, yeah, but now they're paying for air.
I know.
Yeah. That isn't always effective.
Yeah.
That sometimes I have to go in my house and run around, right, and find the right spot to stand because the signal's bad. What are we paying for again?
Bad service. Yeah, bad service.
And then I go to my work phone that I have there, and I pick it up because at least then I can get signal. Right?
Even though we are really filthy with our phones and all that stuff, they're still cleaner than any phone booth ever.
Oh, heck yes.
Right? Remember those days?
Oh, heck yes.
Fox is having trouble.
I don't know how we got on this phone.
Fox is having trouble with Superman because he's like, what's a phone booth, right? Is that like where you take your phone in there and you just talk? It's like a private space, like a cone of silence.
Well, you know, we were walking through a casino, my wife
and Fox.
I. Walking
kids
through a casino, and we heard two kids laughing and pointing. And we kind of, which drew our attention. We go, what are they looking at? They were looking at a payphone. They'd never seen one before. I've heard about
you
that.
Really want to throw a zinger to them. Throw in there a rotary dial ask them what to do with it.
That's right. Yeah, that'll really.
Yeah, that's even better, isn't it?
Okay, here's another question for you about Christmas.
Wow, I don't need this list. He's got them all.
When does Russia celebrate Christmas?
You know, I had that fact once, but I don't know what it is now.
Okay, I think I know.
Okay.
Whenever Putin wants him to.
That's a good answer.
January 6th.
That must be
the Epiphany.
Well, it had to do with the differences in calendars. Yeah, what the origin of it was.
Well, no, they celebrate the Epiphany. That's the last day that you're celebrating. And my mom used to always leave her Christmas tree up, and I still do. I now have a fake one for that reason. because you leave it up until the 6th. That's like the last day of Christmas.
Yeah.
So
I think that's, you know, with
it's surprising that
Russia would do that, tradition like that.
But see, we were originally from.
My wife was brought up when Santa returned to the North.
I didn't want to talk over you, so I didn't.
So we're just drinking. We're drinking beverage alcohol in the studio.
Since when did we start doing
they can't see.
When my wife had a tradition when she was growing up, they would leave their shoes by the Christmas tree on New Year's Eve.
Okay.
So Santa, on his way back to the North Pole, would leave candy in them.
That's gross.
Why? Oh, in a shoe?
Well, yeah. Wouldn't it depend on the wrappers and if it had snowed that night?
Okay, all right.
I got one.
No, wait a minute.
Now, my family does do this, and this is something I still do. But so Santa's elves show up Christmas Eve night with pajamas for everyone. So they slide them under the tree. My grandparents used to change their kids while they were sleeping and put pajamas on them, new ones. So they woke up magic, right? They
got new pajamas. That's awesome.
Right? Plus, back in the day, right, your pajamas are new.
Right.
For pictures on Christmas.
Right. Yeah.
So now as we're leaving, I put them out. Like by the tree and Fox's first in, right? And then they say,
I like
right,
that.
Santa's elves bring.
Well, and then I heard on Tom Sullivan, I was coming in, I was flipping the stations, and I heard Tom Sullivan talking about Festivus. It's a secular holiday celebrated on December 23rd as an alternative to the traditional Christian holiday. And I guess this became really popular during Seinfeld. Jason Alexander talking about Happy Festivus.
Well, it was his dad on the show, and then Kramer was like the big driver of that. Yeah.
That was great.
Yeah,
so we should be saying Happy Festivus because it's December 23rd.
That's right.
Oh, what can you say, right?
I don't know. Yeah.
I don't know either.
Seems to me, what happened
to my screen here?
Just seems to me like, you know, every day is kind of like special, right? It's a holiday. We're a little off schedule, meaning, right, work's a little different.
Oh, and Rand Paul put out his report on the excessive spending. That was the other thing I was going to cover. I'm not going to do it now because we don't have enough time. But
I'm sorry.
Oh, you haven't seen his report? He does annually on
excessive spending. No, the only thing ironic would be if it's like longer than like the tax laws. So it's like 5 billion books. It's like an Al Gore, inventor of the internet thing.
Pretty much. I liked Festivus better. I thought that was a better choice. A little more positive.
Yeah.
All right. So we only have less than a couple minutes left. So you guys, I want to thank you again.
Thank you for putting up with us. That's great.
Well, I want to thank the listeners, right? They put up with us all this time.
They do, and they actually listen, which is really cool.
And you know,
Doris says Festivus is the best of us. Thanks, Doris. Yes, it is.
I mean, people really, right? You keep us going. You give us the ideas to go ahead and keep us striving. Keep me moving for sure. Keep me trying to be better because you're catching up.
Yeah. Yep. Is this a 1 + 1 = 5?
10.
Whatever. Either one.
That's right,
man. And thank you and Merry Christmas to our listeners or whatever holiday it is you celebrate. We hope that you enjoy it.
Yeah.
And take Brian's advice. If you have somebody in the family that's kind of, you know, a little bit on the downside, try not to let it affect your entire holiday season. We know it can't help but affect it some, but... maybe carve out some time for yourself and make things happen that are good for you because it's a good time of year, you know?
It is. It's a great – if you know somebody who, like, could use a good lunch, just so uplifting to take folks that you know that are down or maybe have a challenge.
Or even just text them.
You know
what?
That enthusiasm is contagious, and you can just take them out and give them a smile, and it's amazing.
All right, so we are What's the Story. We are on every Monday between 3 and 5. We hope you will continue to listen in 2020 because we think it's going to be an awesome year. America Matters is doing some wonderful things with broadening their reach, and so hopefully we'll reach you too soon. And again, thank you, listeners, and thank you, everyone here, for being a part of this. We appreciate you.
Yep, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
You wanted to see me?
Yes, please, have a seat. So here's the thing. When this company brought you on, we took a chance.